sex, but I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. I said I love having sex, but I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. Hypnotize mine. 3 6 mafia. And your boy DJ Monte. And it's another. I said I love having sex, but I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. I said I love having sex, but I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. But I'd rather get some head. I said 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 I'd rather get some head.
If you love me, please don't judge me. Got my hands tied, the power's above me. Don't shoot the messenger, I'm just a puppet here. If you wanna place blame, then look to the puppeteer. Family, fortune, envy, jealousy, privilege, passed on, legacy, secret, sabotage, borderline, felony, suicide, subtract, selfish, pedigree, yeah.
Man, just man. Like, Larson has just been unbelievable this year. Like, the talent Larson has shown this year is unbelievable. Like, just what records has Larson not yet accomplished this year? Like, he has now broken the wreck Jeff Gordon's 2001 record of most laps led in a 36-race season. Man, oh man. And he ties Dale Earnhardt's record from 1987 of being the first driver to win 3 straight races twice in the same season. Like, Jesus Christ. I feel like this season for Larson was, like, exactly what we expected him to do at Chip Ganassi, but Ganassi just never had the equipment to do it. So, yeah, this year has just proven that Larson was truly held back by Ganassi all along. And today's also a special day because this day was also the 17-year anniversary of the Rick Henry, of the airplane crash that took 10 people outside Martinsville. And of course, lost in that plane crash was Jeff, Rick Henry's brother Jeff, both of Jeff's twin daughters, HMS lead engineer Randy Dunn, and Rick Henry's son Ricky. And, of course, some HMS GM at the time, Jeff Turner. Of course, I made a community post about this earlier this morning. But, yeah, and hold up. I feel like I'm making a mistake here. I think there's something wrong with my attire for this. Like, let me point here. Do I have this hat on right? No. I don't think this is the right way. This isn't the way Ricky wore it. I think we got to do this the right way. Hang on. There we go. This better? Yes? Okay. All right. Yeah, I think for this video, we need to turn our hats backward for little Ricky. Since Ricky Henrik always wore his hats backwards. But before we talk about what happened with the Cup race today at Kansas, let's talk about the other races that happened this week. So, yeah, the ARCA race happened. I mean, not the ARCA. Xfinity race first happened. And, yeah, quite a few things happened in that race. Like, mainly this race was dominated by Cindric and Ty Gibbs and Allmendinger. Throughout most of this race, it was between those three drivers for the win majorly. But throughout this race, there were 3 crashes that make big hits on 3 chasers. Like Brandon Jones had a crash, and then Sam Mayer decided to turn Harrison Burton right into Noah Gregson and wreck his team. And Mayer effectively wrecked his own teammate. So now Gregson and Harrison Burton are both in holes entering Martinsville. But to be honest, though, Sam, for that minute incident with Sam Mayer, that was a racing incident. Like, I think Sam Mayer was trying to squeeze up behind Harrison Burton, has just misjudged it there. But yeah, you know, this ain't the first time Harrison Burns made a number, has wrecked people, because he's been known to do this in ARCA and in trucks as well. So yeah, some tells me that Sam Mayer might be getting rushed up to Xfinity too quickly. Yeah. But yeah, and you could tell in the post-race interview that Gregson was kind of pissed at Sam Mayer. Because you have Gregson and Harrison Burns still bowing for a title, and Sam Mayer isn't. But at the same time, you know, you're still racing for a win. But yeah, still though, that's that, man. But anyway, despite all that though, Ty Gibbs would still not be denied. And Ty Gibbs gets his fourth Xfinity win of the season. And Ty Gibbs becomes the youngest driver in Xfinity Series history to win four races. The previous record holder was this young driver. I'm not sure if you heard of him before. His name was Joey Logano. And yeah, Logano's been pretty solid in Cup here. So yeah, say whatever you want about Ty Gibbs and everything about him and how he's a Richie boy, but make no mistake about it, Ty Gibbs is extremely talented. And you can, and before anyone says that, oh, but it's only because of that car. Man, if that was the case, then how come Ty Dillon didn't win in the 54 this year? If that's the case, how come Denny Hamlin didn't win his one-off race? Or how come Martin Truex Jr. didn't win his one-off race? If it was truly the car, it's talent. The talent is there for sure. Especially when Ty Gibbs almost has as many wins in that car as Kyle Busch this year. So, yeah. But, yeah, Ty Gibbs gets another win. So, with that, it means that nobody locks themselves into the round to the final four for Xfinity. So, yeah, both races in this round have been won by the 54 car. And it's been by two different drivers. John Hunter Nemechek last week and Ty Gibbs this week. So, yeah. And entering Martinsville next week, there's still four spots in the Xfinity final four up for grabs. Just like the Truck Series next week. Since the Truck Series still has four spots up for grabs. Also, this weekend, the ARCA season finale happened. And yeah, to make a long story short, Ty Gibbs locked up the championship by just simply starting the car. So yeah, Ty Gibbs, enjoy that ARCA title. That's probably the easiest you're ever going to win a championship in your entire career. Just starting the car, because Ty Gibbs had that big a points cushion all year. So yeah, for the first time in Ty Gibbs' career, he gets to take out that Metro card and hop aboard the ARCA W train. But yeah, still, there was still an ARCA race to go. Like, this race was fucking terrible for ARCA. Like, at one point in this race, there was like four or five cars on the lead lap at one point. Like, Ty Gibbs was just laying a fucking smackdown on the field. Until a caution late with six to go, and then set up a late race restart. And then on the final restart, Nick Sanchez would get ahead of Ty Gibbs on that restart. And then Nick Sanchez would be able to hold him off. And Nick Sanchez gets his first career ARCA win. So Nick Sanchez is officially a winner in the ARCA series. So yeah, Nick Sanchez gets a win to end the season, but Ty Gibbs gets the bigger trophy at the end of the night since he finished second, since Ty Gibbs wins the ARCA title. So yeah, Sanchez won the battle, but Ty Gibbs won the war. So yeah, congrats to Ty Gibbs on his ARCA title. Well deserved this year, congrats to him. But yeah, so yeah, that wraps up the ARCA season. So yeah, a lot of the seasons are already wrapped up. Like, the only seasons left are the Mexico series. Like, their next race isn't until like November. Also, there was a Mexico series race today in San Luis Potosí, but I haven't saw who won yet, so we'll skip over that race. Maybe we'll talk about it another time. But yeah, I'm not sure if that race is happening right now or what. So yeah, anyway, and also the Euro Series season finale is next week with their doubleheader. So yeah, the Euro Series wraps up their season next week on Halloween. So yeah, that series will be done. We still got ARCA West, which wraps up in 2 weeks at Phoenix, and then we got Trucks, Xfinity, and Cup. So we're almost done on racing for the year. Like, we're almost in the off season. Like, we only got, after the Cup race, we only have two more weeks left. And other than F1, but that's about it. But yeah, anyway, to the Cup race at Kansas. Well, the race, we would have a red flag 10 laps in for light rain. And then we went under the 30-minute lightning clock. Never mind, we're not going to talk about the cup race right now. We'll come back to that in a little bit. Let's talk instead about the other race that happened in the U.S. today. On American soil, in Texas, in Austin, at COTA. The F1 race at COTA. So yeah, this race, like, Lewis Hamilton and Max Verstappen had a really good battle for this win. Like, it was between Hamilton and Verstappen for sure, just like almost every race this year. Like, the opening lap, Verstappen really made an aggressive pass on Verstappen, forcing him off the track. After Verstappen tried to force Lewis off the track, like, they're both racing aggressively the shit out of each other. But in the end, Verstappen was able to get ahead of Lewis Hamilton on pit strategy with the undercut. And despite Lewis Hamilton's best efforts throughout this race, it still wasn't enough to stop Verstappen, as Verstappen was able to hold off the late charge from Lewis Hamilton. And Max Verstappen gets his 8th win of the season, winning at COTA. And for the first time in Max Verstappen's career, he finally wins a race on American soil and extends his championship lead to 12 points. I should also mention that this race, there are a lot of fucking Verstappen fans in the crowd. I guess at least 80% of this crowd was Verstappen fans. Which is kind of weird because I thought the border was closing that Verstappen, and I didn't know that Verstappen fans could travel across the pond from the Netherlands to the US. Because the fucking Orange Army invaded this track. Because there are a lot of Verstappen fans in this track. Like, when Verstappen took the lead from Hamilton, the fucking place erupted. Like, it almost felt like Dale Jr. or Chase Elliott was taking the lead. Like, it was that kind of reaction when Verstappen took the lead. But hey, you know, then again, a majority of the fans want Lewis Hamilton to lose. So, hey, fair enough, I guess. But yeah, I think it's safe to say Verstappen's definitely a fan favorite in the United States for sure. And of course, I believe the next race is next week in Mexico, as we're down to 5 races left in the F1 season. And the championship battle between Hamilton and Verstappen, where it's now 12 points between the two with 5 to go. And of course, also, this F1 race set attendance records, because there was 140 fans in attendance at COTA. And there was, I believe, close to 380 to 400,000 fans in total at COTA this weekend, which is damn. Like, I mean, damn. Like, I think F1 has officially gained whatever popularity F1 lost with America after Indy 2005, they effectively got it back at COTA. Especially when they're going to have 2 races in the U.S. next year with the Miami Grand Prix in May next year. And there's even talks that F1 may have a 3rd race coming up in the near future. Whether that race is, there's been rumors that it could be the Las Vegas Strip, a street circuit in Las Vegas or whatnot. Who knows? Maybe F1 makes things right, then goes back to Indianapolis. We'll have to see what happens in the future. And there's also been rumors that Michael Andretti could be buying Alfa Romeo, and it becomes Andretti F1, and that they could bring Colton Herta to F1, which would be very interesting for sure. Like, definitely F1 is popular with the U.S. now. Now, I think the popularity could really go to new heights if they get an American driver in the sport. If they can get an American driver in the sport, then I think the popularity really goes up. But yeah, it's great to see that. It's great to see those kind of numbers at COTA. It's great to see that. Hopefully NASCAR can come close to those kind of numbers at COTA next year in March. But yeah, anyway, back to the cup race now. So after that 30-minute red flag, we go back racing in the cup race. Let's be real, this entire race was dominated by Hendrick Motorsports. Like, this race was dominated between Kyle Larson, Chase Elliott, and William Byron, the 3 amigos at HMS. And Alex Bowman was nowhere close to their level. Like, I think it's safe to say that Alex Bowman is definitely the weak link at HMS. I think that 48 team needs a massive overhaul in the offseason. Like, they need to massively overhaul that team. The good news for Bowman is he's signed on till 2023. But that 48 team needs to be massively overhauled. I'll let Rick Henrik handle it this way, but Rick, if the results for Bowman remain the same next year as they were this year, then we'll do it my way next year. And my way, you don't want to know, because my way is going to be the way to get shit done. And I'm going to be given the harshest solutions possible. So yeah, just bear warned. But yeah, throughout this race, it was dominated by HMS. There were a number of tire failures throughout this race. Like, Brad Keselowski had a tire failure early. Truex had a tire failure early. Blaney had two tire failures, and he ended up in the wall. And then Kyle Busch also had two tire failures as well. Now, Kyle Busch's second tire failure came before Blaney's did. But yeah, like, almost all the JGR, almost all the Penske cars had tire issues too. Same deal with Logano. Logano had some tire issues too. Like, it was crazy in the number of tire failures in this race. Like, it was insane. But yeah, then when Blaney blew his tire, anything Kyle Busch lost there, he got back. And all that does now is just make that fourth spot interesting for that fourth and final spot into the final four next week. Since Denny Hamlin and Chase Elliott both did the bare minimum to gain ground on everyone else taking the issues. Like, all Elliott and Hamlin had to do was just stay out of trouble and not fuck up, and both of them did. But yeah, to the finish of this race, though, the turning point in this race was that caution with 50 to go led to a bunch of pit stops after Kyle Larson's team made a bad gamble staying out when everyone else pitted, and he got burned on old tires, but he was still able to stay in the top five despite that. He was still able to hold his own. And then Larson was able to get a much-needed restart, and then during the pit stops, William Byron got a speeding penalty, so he had to go to the rear. The good news was there was like 14 cars on the lead lap, so he didn't have to go too far. And then on that restart, Chase Elliott then dominated the next part of the race until the final restart after the Blaney tire incident. Because the original 50 to go caution was Ryan Newman spinning out. The next caution after that was Blaney's tire failure. And then on the final restart of the race, Kyle Larson would get the lead after Chase Elliott tried to make a block on Kevin Harvick and reacted too late. And then Harvick was able to get underneath Chase and make a aggressive three-wide pass. Oh, what, Chase? You really think NASCAR telling both of them to cool off was going to make Harvick cut any slack to Chase? Bitch, you have no fucking clue who the hell Kevin Harvick is. Harvick has never gave a damn about NASCAR's disciplinary for years. Why the hell would Harvick start now? So, yeah, Harvick is definitely not cutting Chase any slack from now to the rest of the year. Maybe for the rest of Harvick's career. He's going to race Chase extremely hard. But, yeah, despite that, Larson was able to pull away. And then Chase Elliott was able to make a comeback and get past Harvick with a somewhat of an aggressive pass, really pitching him almost into the wall. But Chase was able to get by Harvick no problem. And despite Chase Elliott's best efforts to try and catch Kyle Larson in the closing laps, it still wasn't enough. Like, I'll give Chase Elliott kudos, though. He really drove his ass off the last seven laps. Like, he hit the, like, Chase was running Larson down so hard, he went in the wall three laps in a row in turn two. Like, he scraped the wall three times in a row. It's like, holy fuck. Chase was really trying to do what Larson was doing at Darlington, trying the video game move, and it did not work. And then after the third time, I think Chase just gave up and let Larson take the win. And Chase decided, you know what? I gained a lot of points on the competition. A lot of the field had tire issues. I'm just going to back off and take the points. And with that, it just made things easier for Kyle Larson. And Kyle Larson goes on and cruises to a ninth win of the season. 9 wins for Larson this year. Hot damn. And to be honest, Larson's already locked into the next round anyway. So yeah, so Larson's just enjoying the next 2 weeks with nothing to lose. So yeah, this race is kind of more like a test and tune session for Phoenix, especially Martinsville next week. So yeah, and also if anyone's keeping score, this is the eighth time that Kyle Larson and Chase Elliott have finished 1-2 in a race. And Kyle Larson now leads that series over Chase Elliott 6-2. I think it's safe to say Kyle Larson is easily the championship favorite entering Phoenix. Especially when Larson has won 4 of the last 6 now. Like, he has 4 wins in the chase this year. Like, almost half of Larson's wins have come in the last 6 races. Like, Larson has really gone hot in at the right time. And when you're in the final 4, you need as much momentum as possible entering the championship race. So, yeah. This is that. So, yeah. Like I said, the start of chase. This was easily, just as easily, Larson's championship to lose. So, yeah. Larson gets another win. And it's only fitting that this win comes on a 17-year anniversary of that plane crash that took away a lot of HMS folks that day, and a lot of employees, including Rick Hendrick's son, Ricky. And, of course, Kyle Larson pointing to the skies, paying tribute to Ricky and everyone lost. And it's only fitting that Kyle Larson was driving the Hendrick car scheme, because that paint scheme was the paint scheme that Ricky Hendrick used to drive in the Busch Series and Truck Series. And it's very symbolic that this win comes at Kansas Speedway, which was the same track that Ricky Hendrick got his one and only Truck Series win 20 years ago. So, yeah, for Ricky Hendrick, this one's for you, man. This one's for you. This one is for you, Ricky, and everyone lost that day. To all the Hendrick fans watching, I say turn your hats backwards right now. Grab whatever drink you have and let's have a toast to all those that we lost 17 years ago to pay tribute. They may be gone, but they will forever always be in our hearts. In loving memory all the way. But yeah. Like, man, Larson has just been absolutely unreal this year. Like, just absolutely unreal. Like, Jesus Christ, I was not expecting this kind of season out of Larson. Like, at the bare most this year, I was expecting Larson to win maybe 5 races this year. But to see him win 9 races, it's fucking crazy. But fuck me, man. Fuck, what a dream season out of Larson. Now, do I think Larson's going to win the last 2 races? I don't think Larson is probably going to win out. I think at the bare most, Larson probably wins 4 of the last 5 races to end the year. I don't see Larson winning Martinsville, but I definitely see him winning Phoenix and winning the championship. I think Larson probably ends the year with 10 wins. I don't see 11 wins. But fuck me, man. I did not think, but fuck, Larson now has 2 wins in this round. Larson's the only driver safe entering Martinsville. I don't see Larson winning 4 in a row and winning Martinsville next week, because Martinsville is Larson's worst track. And yes, I know Larson finished top 5 in the spring. That doesn't mean jack shit. Larson's track record at Martinsville is pretty abysmal. I guess the one positive, though, is that next week Larson's on the pole for Martinsville next week, so maybe there's a plus there. But he has Chase Elliott on the front row, and Chase is really damn good at Martinsville. But yeah, for all the Chase Elliott fans that are pissed about Larson winning another race, don't be too pissed off. Like, Chase still had a solid points day, and Chase is in a really good position to make the final 4 next week at Martinsville. I'll just say this, Elliott fans. Chase Elliott's in a way better position entering Martinsville this year than he was last year. Because last year, I believe Chase was like 25 points out and needed to win the race to get in. This year, Chase Elliott's 34 points to the good ahead of that cut line. Hell, Chase Elliott's in a position where he doesn't even need to win Martinsville. Chase could just run top 5, top 10 at Martinsville and do the bare minimum, and he can make it into the final 4. But, if we learned anything from Harvick's choke last year when Harvick blew a 40-point lead in 1 race, we know one thing at Martinsville. No points gap is safe. Especially in a cutoff race. So, yeah, I think Chase just needs to run top. If Chase just runs top 5, top 10, he's good. Then he's in the final 4. If he just runs top 5, top 10, he's in the final 4. That's simple as that. So yeah, and I do have a couple race win diecasts. I believe I should have the Chase Elliott Phoenix win die from the championship race last year in this week. I also have a couple Jimmy Johnson diecasts coming in too. And if anyone's wondering, the only 2021 diecast I have in is Kyle Larson's Nation Guard scheme. I sadly don't have the Henrik Carr scheme in one yet. But this is the only one I have, which is, hey, it's still a pretty cool scheme. It's pretty much the Henrik Carr scheme. It's just black and green and white. So, yeah. So, yeah, I got a couple diecast unboxings to do this week. The other two diecasts are Jimmy Johnson. The last two Jimmy Johnson 2020 diecasts I don't have. So, yeah, anyway, that'll wrap it up here. And that's all I got to say. So, yeah, time to go celebrate another win. Like, 9 wins for Larson this year. Jesus Christ. What a dream season out of Larson. Martinsville next week. If I was Quip Daniels, I would rest a few key members of Larson's pit crew so that they can have Max rest and be healthy and ready to go entering Phoenix. Like, I would throw maybe some second or third stringers in onto the pit crew. Because Martinsville, for Larson, it's pretty much a race that doesn't matter to him anyway. Even though it technically is a home race still for Henrik Motorsports, since Rick Henrik grew up in Virginia, not that far away at Martinsville. So yeah, anyway though, on to Martinsville next week. See you then. But before we wrap that one up, let's first take a look at the Xfinity and Cup Chase grids entering the cutoff race at Martinsville next week. And this is the last time we'll be doing voiceovers for this kind of thing for this season. So let's enjoy it while we can. So to the Xfinity Chase grid, nobody's locked in. So there's still 4 spots still up for grabs in the Xfinity Final Four at Martinsville next week. So Austin Cindric and AJ Allmendinger, both of them are 47 points to the good. They're pretty comfortable on points. But it's those last 2 spots is when it gets interesting. Because you have Justin Allgaier 9 points to the good, and you got Daniel Hemric 7 points to the good. Like, for Hemric and Allgaier, they just have to stay up front, gain points, and just stay out of trouble, and they're in. Justin Haley, 7 points out. Justin Haley, like, he needs to have a solid run and hope that Hemric or Allgaier have some issues. And as long as someone below the cutoff line doesn't win. Now, Noah Gregson, he's 24 points out. He's almost in a must-win scenario. He pretty much is, but at the same time, though, Gregson could still make it in on points, but he's going to need a lot of help if he wants to make it into the Final Four. Like, he's going to have to run well, and he needs Allgaier, Hemric, and Haley to all struggle. Now, for Brandon Jones and Harrison Byrne, they're both 41 and 50 points out. Let's be real. There's no way they're making up that many points in one race. They're both in a must-win scenario. So yeah, for both of them, it's simply put, their season's on the line next Sunday. They have to win Martinsville if they want to compete for a championship next at Phoenix in the desert. But if someone below the cutoff line wins, then it gets a kind of interesting. Then it's a battle between Hemric and Allgaier for that 4th spot. So yeah, I think Cindric and Allmendinger, they're pretty safe for now. But as we learned from Martinsville last year, no points gap is safe. Now to the other side, to the Cup Chase grid, we have 3 spots still up for grabs entering Martinsville, as Kyle Larson is the only driver safe entering Martinsville. So Chase Elliott, he's 34 points to the good. Chase Elliott's in a way better position than he was 365 days ago. Because last year, Chase was in a must-win scenario entering Martinsville. This year, Chase Elliott just has to run top 5, top 10, and he's pretty much good. He just has to do the bare minimum. And he's in. Denny Hamlin, he's only 2 points. He's 32 points to the good. Hamlin's pretty safe too. And given how good he runs at Martinsville, I think he's pretty much a safe lock too. But this is Denny Hamlin we're talking about. But that 4th and final spot is where it gets interesting, with everyone below him having issues. Kyle Busch. He was able to salvage whatever he could after Blaney's issues, and Kyle Busch is now 1 point to the good for that 4th and final spot. Ryan Blaney, he's only 1 point out. Martin Truex Jr. is 3 points out, and Brad Keselowski is 6 points out. So Blaney just needs to finish ahead of Kyle Busch and gain a couple points to get in. Martin Truex Jr. needs to gain a couple points too. And on Blaney and Kyle Busch, Kieslowski, same deal, just needs to run well and needs Kyle Busch, Blaney, and Truex to all have issues or win the race. And Logano, well, Logano is kind of in a must-win scenario. At the same time, he isn't. Logano could still make it in on points, but he has to run well and needs a lot of help. But if someone below that cutoff line wins, then it gets interesting. Kyle Busch is going to have to gain a lot of points and would need Hamlin or Elliott to struggle at Martinsville if someone below the cutoff line wins. But if we learned anything from Harvick last year, nothing is safe entering Martinsville. That is a fact. So yeah, Elliott fans, you can breathe a little sigh of relief, but at the same time, just remember what happened to Harvick last year when Harvick entered 40 points to the good last year and then failed to show up when it mattered the most. But yeah, anyway, that's the Chase Grids entering next week, and we also got the Trucks Chase Grid as well. So yeah, next week, we will have four drivers. We will find out who's competing for the championship at Phoenix and who will get sent to Elimination Station next week. So yeah, that's all I gotta say. See you all at Martinsville next week. Peace.
That's the kind of person that you are. You know, you look at Hendrick Motorsports as family, and to me, it elevated this organization to another level. You know, I mean, it changed my life, really. And you drove that. So thank you, Rick.
A lot of people think it's corny, but you grow together and you get tight and you care about each other, and then you go out with a mission to conquer and to win. I mean, it's just amazing how fast time rolls on. I've seen a million miles, met a million faces, took all I knew to reach all these places, and I'd do it again if it brings me back to you. So have you ever been caught in a sea of despair, and your moment of truth is the day that you say I'm not scared? Put your hands in the air if you hear me out there. I've been looking for you all day and night. Shine a light in the dark, let me see where you are, cause I'm not gonna leave you behind. If I told you that you're not alone, and I show you this is where you belong, put your hands.
I can't thank you guys enough, especially you, Rick, for believing in me, making this place feel like home for myself and everybody here. You know, we all feel like we're part of the family, and I'm just forever grateful for the opportunity, and can't thank you enough.
I was a Yankee coming down in a Southern sport, so Rick, I owe you everything.
It's all about people, and I thank you guys, because without you, this place wouldn't be here. From the five people up in the 10 building to 100 races and then 200 races and 10 championships. If you look through this place over almost 30 years now, everybody that's been here has put a brick on it. So thank you, guys.